This conference will now be recorded.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. As a part of anesthesiology topic, today we'll be discussing something about general anesthesia. So in particular, I'll be telling about the technique of general anesthesia. Anywhere in the world, without giving anesthesia, no surgery can be done. So this you know. But there is a particular protocol of giving general anesthesia to any patient. This differs based on the type of surgery the patient is undergoing. So we'll go into the details of GA as such. General anesthetics have been performed since 1846 when Thomas Green Morton William, he demonstrated the first anesthetic using ether, of course, in USA. Local anesthetics arrived after 1884. So it can be described as a reversible state of unconsciousness with inability to respond to a standard surgical stimulus. So we say that if in 50% of the patients, if they show no response to a standard surgical stimulus, that is what we define for any drug. So we define ED50, effective dose 50, for all the people undergoing surgery using a standardized surgical stimulus. So here the GA can be discussed as a reversible state of unconsciousness with inability to respond to a standard surgical stimulus. The term which is important is reversible. And also it can be defined as a medically induced coma and loss of protective reflexes resulting from the administration of one or more general anesthetic agents. In modern anesthetic practice, this involves the triad of unconsciousness, analgesia, and muscle relaxation. So without having unconsciousness or proper analgesia or muscle relaxation, so the standard GA cannot be given. So we can see the three circles here which are important. Amnesia, so where the person does not remember that he has been given anesthesia and all the trauma of having a surgery performed on his own body. So that should not be there. So for that, we need to provide adequate amnesia, analgesia, obviously, and unconsciousness. So to look at the overview of giving GA, it is a complex procedure involving pre-anesthetic assessment, administration of drugs which can provide general anesthesia. So we need to monitor the cardiorespiratory system. We have to provide adequate analgesia, airway and fluid management is important. And obviously, we need to cover his post-operative analgesia part also. And this has to be maintained through the process of induction of general anesthesia, maintaining general anesthesia as far as the surgery is going on, and how do we really taper the anesthetic agents so that the person is able to breathe on his own, and that is called emergence. And we have to cover the part of post-operative complications, post-operative side effects of the general anesthetic agents, and other post-operative implications of GA also. This is the overview. If we start by taking the patient to the pre-anesthetic checkup room, so we need to check his history, examination, investigations, and for that, in the history part, we need to find out what his medical history is holding up. So whether he is diabetic, whether he is hypertensive, whether he has he's on any current medications, or he had already undergone any surgery under any type of anesthesia. So this is the history part we need to assess, so that which is the best protocol of GA in this current scenario. So, and coming to the examination part, we need to take his age, weight, so that his BMI can be calculated, body mass index, and based on the body mass index, we can know that the person is normal weight or overweight, mild obesity, moderate obesity, severe obesity, or morbid obesity and super obesity. So these are the classification of obesity, and based on the type of BMI and type of the body structure of the person, we can know which doses of anesthetic agents can be given. So we need to find out the teeth condition. So we need to know whether the person is having any loose teeth, so that when we try to intubate and maintain him on mechanical ventilation, so no tooth should be dislodged, and which can have the hazard of stacking up in the esophagus, or for that matter, it can enter the trachea also. So which can be detrimental for oxygen ventilation management. And airway assessment in the form of mouth opening, temporomandibular joint assessment, neck flexibility, and head extension has to be done. And routing and coming to the investigations, so they have to be relevant to the age. So when a person of 30 or 35 years, female person, comes for any cholecystectomy, like the person is having very severe pain in the right hypochondrial region, and the person is having the stones in the gallbladder, so then that can produce inflammation and cause cholecystitis. The most probable diagnosis is cholecystitis, and the person needs to undergo the process of cholecystectomy. So if that person comes, so we only have this hepatobiliary system at fault. So we don't need to go into extensive investigations of all the other systems. We need to assess the basic problem and the problem with which the person has come and the associated system alone. So we need to investigate the person based on the age and the probable medical condition for which the person has come to be treated. So the investigations in this so-called scenario of cholecystectomy will be like having the liver function tests and the basic ECG and routine complete blood picture. You don't need to go into renal function tests. We don't need to go into the 2D echocardiogram or any other deep investigations. So this is how we check in the pre-anesthetic room for history, examination, and investigations to formulate a plan for the best combination of drugs, dosages, and the degree of monitoring that is needed. If a person of 75 or 80 years comes to the surgery, and the person is having multiple comorbid conditions like hypertension, diabetes, previous coronary artery disease, on blood thinning agents like antiplatelet medications or any other things, so we need to continue that. If the person is hypothyroid patient on Eltroxin or Thyronorm, more than 50 micrograms or more than 75 micrograms per day, so we need to understand his pathophysiology of the original system, as well as formulate a plan for which the doses, drugs, and the monitoring that has to be done in this scenario. So if a person like our patient of 75 years, if he comes, we should understand that when GA is given, the anesthesia can produce changes in the sympathetic nervous system as well as the parasympathetic nervous system. So the monitoring will be different. So in a 30-year patient, previous patient, and this 75-year hypothetical patient, so when monitoring is concerned, we don't need any invasive or aggressive monitoring in the first patient. But as well as in 70 or 75-year person, so we need to strictly monitor his vital parameters, ECG, intraoperative or immediate postoperative echocardiogram. We need to monitor his ECA echocardiography, and we need to monitor invasive blood pressure. So this type of change in the monitoring is very much essential. So that plan is formulated during our PAC, that is pre-anesthetic checkup. So we need to check the fasting time and also assess for the airway, so that appropriate management of the airway can be done. So these are the objectives of anesthesia. So the first thing is to provide unconsciousness, amnesia, analgesia, oxygenation, and ventilation. So all the body organs, they happen to manage their oxygen percentage. This is like supply of oxygen or oxygen delivery, if you recollect your physiology concepts of oxygenation or oxygen cascade, how the atmosphere containing 21% of the oxygen is slowly reaching down to the mitochondrial level, where the cellular basic processes or metabolism is happening, and your citric acid cycle or glycolysis, whatever is happening, electron transport is happening at the level of ribosome, smooth endoplasmic reticulum. So there, the 4% or 2% of oxygen is reaching. So from 21% in the atmosphere to the 2% to 4% of oxygen concentration or pressure at the microbial level. So this oxygenation and ventilation is very important for all the enzymes to properly function in the body, so that all the organs are managing their aerobic metabolism without going into lactic metabolism or anaerobic metabolism, where the byproduct or the main product will be lactic acidosis, with the production of less number of ATP. So we are trying to manage his functions based on the mechanical ventilation inside the operation theater by monitoring their oxygenation and ventilation so that all the organ systems are functioning normally. So this is our aim in the operation theater. And homeostasis, this is what I said. So temperature management, all the oxygenation, pH management of the enzymes, and all the aerobic metabolisms have been maintained in the operation theater. And airway management is necessary by putting up a endotracheal tube, or if that is not required, so we can put up a face mask and provide this oxygen. Reflex management. So once the patient is under the surgical anesthesia and the procedure is going on, at times when the surgical depth of anesthesia is not adequate, the person will regain his own reflexes. That has to be immediately submerged, and routine use of additions or additives or adjuncts of anesthetic agents have to be given so that the patient maintains his surgical depth. And muscle relaxation is very important for the surgical procedures where the muscles are completely relaxed and the surgery is going on. So for example, if the person is undergoing any abdominal surgery and the person happens to be in a lower levels of anesthesia and the muscle relaxation is not appropriate, the surgeon finds it very difficult for opening the abdomen alone, leave alone the management of other additions, management of the intra-abdominal organs, so separating them, dissecting them, and holding up the organ in problem and in particular, so removing it, ligating it, dissecting it. This is all becomes a very tardy job. So if muscle relaxation is not adequate, so that's why providing adequate or more than adequate muscle relaxation during the surgical procedure is very important. And obviously our monitoring. So these are the objective anesthesia which anesthetic team takes care of. So this is the anesthetic plan. So after the PAC checkup is over, so we need to understand what type of pre-medications can be given to the patient, what is the airway management, how we are inducing the patient, how we are maintaining, and what type of muscle relaxation is given true to the surgical procedure. And intraoperative management of monitoring, positioning, fluid management, and special techniques if at all required. So how do we manage? And in the postoperative management, the main part is the pain control. And postoperative nausea and vomiting is one of the main complication or side effect of the anesthetic drugs which the patient complains of. And the complications of postoperative ventilation and hemodynamic monitoring is very much important. So formulating an anesthetic plan of pre-medications, general anesthesia, induction, maintenance, muscle relaxation, and intraoperative management and postoperative management is what it takes to really do on paper and formulate a plan. So coming to the NPO status, we don't want any patient with full stomach coming to the surgery. So if a person with adequate or sizable secretions or any food is present in the stomach, if that person is given anesthesia, the gastroesophageal sphincter, the lower gastroesophageal sphincter, with its tone, it maintains or separates the gastric cavity from the oral cavity, where the secretions, if at all they are aspirated in the lungs, can cause aspiration pneumonia. So for that, we don't need the person with full stomach. So for maintaining this NPO status, like nothing by mouth or nil per oral status, we need to abstain him from taking any solid food 8 hours before the induction, liquids 4 hours before induction, or the clear water 2 hours before induction. So that is the time which takes for the food and other secretions to pass the duodenum. So they cross the stomach, they enter the duodenum, and they pass through the duodenum, so that will not have any effect of gastric regurgitation into the oral cavity and subsequent assessment or subsequent damage to the lung tissue. In pediatrics or in children, we ask the mother to stop giving breast milk at least 4 hours before the standard procedure of giving induction of anesthetic drugs. So pre-medication. So our aim of giving pre-medication is to induce drowsiness and to induce relaxation, and the person is calm, comfortable. And if the person is agitative, or if he is really anxious, we can give some sedatives like benzodiazepines, midazolam. Midazolam is a short-acting benzodiazepine that can be given to a person comfortably. And we can provide narcotics, which not only provide analgesia, that can also cause a slight respiratory depression and relaxation. So that is the time. So before giving anesthesia, before 2 hours to the surgery to 2 minutes before the surgery. It depends on the type of drug we are giving to the person. So this is our aim of giving pre-medication. And coming to the airway examination. So even though the person is adequately examined in the PAC room, like pre-anesthetic assessment of airway, so on the table also, on the surgery table, the person is again checked for the airway. So this is the Malampati classification, where the person is sitting straight in front of the doctor assessing his airway, and he opened his mouth to the maximum extent possible. If you see that, if you see his hard palate, soft palate, uvula, and the complete uvula along with the posterior pharyngeal wall, this is class 1. In class 2, we cannot see the tip of the uvula, and in class 3, we can only see the soft palate, not the hard palate, not the uvula. And in class 4, only hard palate is visible. So if we can assess the easiness of intubating the person for providing anesthesia, if the person is class 1 and class 2. As the class increases on the Malampati classification, we find it very difficult for intubating as well as for ventilating the patient. So this is very important, because if we fail to provide a patent airway during the surgery, then obviously the person dies. So this is the sniffing position. So for intubating the person in the operation theater, this is like sniffing the morning air position, like the flexion at the cervical joint and extension of the atlanto-occipital joint. So by putting a 10 to 15 centimeters of the pillow below the head, we can achieve this sniffing position of sniffing the morning air position, and that is very important for having a patent airway. So we have three axes in the oral cavity. So one is the oral axis, pharyngeal axis, and laryngeal axis. If we align the laryngeal and pharyngeal axis into a straight line, and this a oral axis being at 90 to 120 degrees with the other two axes, that provides adequate path for intubating the patient. So this we'll see here. So here we are first ventilating the person with the help of mask, face mask, and providing a tight seal with the help of two hands if needed. And the our mouth is open, and here with the help of laryngoscope blade, and using the handle and laryngoscope blade, which is having a light here, so we can assess and check for the patent airway, and we try to intubate. So this is the mask ventilation and intubation. So here we are having the laryngoscope blades here, three types. So this is the Miller blade, this is the McIntosh blade, and we are seeing the handle here. So the first thing is to slightly lift the epiglottis here and try to visualize the vocal cords. So once we are inside it, we are lifting up the epiglottis here, and after visualizing the vocal cords, so we now have the cricoid cartilage to press over the esophagus against the posterior surface of the trachea, so that only the glottic opening is patent, and after that we can introduce the endotracheal tube. This is the laryngeal view. We can see with the help of any bronchoscope or endoscope that is passed through the oral cavity. So here we are seeing the uvula, and underneath one we are seeing the epiglottis. So once we are beneath that one and lifting up the epiglottis, we can see that these two glistening white structures are the vocal cords. After giving adequate general anesthetic drugs and paralyzing agents, these two cords are separated, showing us the trachea here. So once the vocal cords are visualized, all that is needed is to pass the endotracheal tube through the vocal cords. Okay. So this is the laryngeal view of the oral cavity and the glottic opening. So this is normal, and this is very successful in a person with low body weight, low body mass index. But what about this type of patient? If this type of person comes for any surgery, so how are we going to manage? This is called difficult airways. That's why in the pre-anesthetic checkup, so the assessment of airway with the help of Malampati classification and keeping ready all the gadgets of difficult airway and the difficult intubation, anticipating that is very important. So if this type of lady is coming, and obviously if you ask her to open her mouth by asking her to sit in front of you and asking her to open the mouth and trying to assess the airway, so we can always find it very difficult, and Malampati grading 4 or more will be present in this lady. So if we try to extend the neck, that is very difficult in this lady. So we know that flexion at the cervical joint and extension of the atlantic occipital joint is very important for maintaining the laryngeal and pharyngeal axis, and with the help of oral access and the instrument you have already seen, the handle and the Macintosh blade of intubation. So that is very difficult to be passed in this lady. So what type of area equipment is needed in this lady? So we need something called fiber optic scope here. So we have this tube, fiber optic scope, where we are seeing through this one. So this can be attached to a monitor, and as we are doing the laparoscopy procedures, so we can look at the monitor and do also. But here we are having this eyepiece. Through this eyepiece, we can see, we'll pass this through the nose, and once it reaches the glottis, we can, we'll push through this one. So here, which is not shown, is the endotracheal tube is already rail tracked into this one. So in the normal procedure, what we do in the operation theater, our endotracheal tube is passed into this one, and rail tracked into this one, and kept ready here at the level of this one. And once the tip is through the glottic opening, so we can just track it down the endotracheal tube on this endoscope and provide patent airway. So this type of difficult airway mandates use of fiber optic intubation. Okay, this is the tracheal view. This is the tracheal view. We are seeing, looking at the trachea. Once we are through the glottic opening and gone inside the trachea, so we encounter this type of structure. This is the carina. So we are seeing the left main bronchus going here and right main bronchus going here. So we need to keep the tip of the endotracheal tube half an inch above the carina, half an inch above this carina. We don't need to enter this left main bronchus or right main bronchus. Okay. So this is the trachea and carina view. And this is the laryngeal mask airway. So if we encounter difficulty in such a scenario, and if we can't intubate with the standard endotracheal tube through the trachea, we can use something called laryngeal mask airway, which is a type of supraglottic airway. And this need not be pushed inside the trachea. This stands, or this is kept over the epiglottis, over the glottic opening and epiglottis, and the bulb is inflated, which will form a closed seal. This tip separates the esophageal opening from the tracheal opening, and through this aperture, whatever the air or oxygen is pumped through the machine, that is directly reaching the trachea, and that will inflate the lungs and provide oxygenation. So these are the types of supraglottic airways. So once the airway examination is done, and the difficult airway is assessed, and all the standard gadgets and the gold standard of fiber optic intubation is kept ready, we'll try to induce the patient. So we have two types of IV induction. So one, IV induction and inhalation induction. Inhalation induction is where the intravenous access is very difficult, and there is anticipated difficult intubation. Or in children, we prefer inhalation induction rather than intravenous induction. So here, in the IV induction is very fast in onset, and it avoids excitatory phase of anesthesia. That means, after giving proper pre-medications in the form of anti-anxiety drugs and analgesic drugs, if we start giving induction agents, that will provide very fast onset, and the person will not have any excitatory phase. So in inhalation induction, the person is always resisting our anesthesia. So that is what we call submerging or dismissing the excitatory phase. So we have three drugs which are mainly useful for providing induction. So propofol, you might have already heard this drug. The short-acting agent, this is used for induction, maintenance of general anesthesia, and sedation in adult patients and in children more than 3 years of age. It is a highly protein-bound in vivo and is metabolized by conjugation in the liver. The side effects are pain on injection because it is having eglacithin and phosphatidylated glycol in its composition. That's why it produces pain on injection. It will produce hypotension by blocking the sympathetic nervous system, and that's how it causes hypertension, and it will produce transient apnea immediately after the induction. So we have the other drug is thiopental sodium, also called sodium thiopental. It is also a rapid onset ultra short acting barbiturate, which reaches the brain and causes unconsciousness within 30 to 45 seconds. The short duration of action is due to its redistribution away from the central circulation towards muscle and fat. So the short time of redistribution, this is defined as the time taken for the drug to reach the brain and produce unconsciousness. This is one arm brain circulation. This is one arm brain cycle. So this arm brain cycle is very less in time for sodium thiopental, owing to the fact that it redistributes away from the central circulation. That means from the intravenous spaces to the muscle and fats, it redistributes, and that is how it the short duration of action is present for this drug. The dose is 3 to 7 milligrams per kg body weight, and for propofol, the previous drug, it is 1.5 to 2.5 milligrams per kg for induction, and here the standard dose will be 3 to 7 milligrams per kg. Most often for a adult patient of 50 to 60 kilograms, we'll be using 5 milligrams per kg body weight of 250 milligrams for inducing the patient. That means the process is producing unconsciousness on the part of the patient. That's it. So it also causes hypotension, apnea, and airway obstruction. We have one more drug, ketamine, ketamine hydrochloride to be exact, and it is a general dissociative anesthetic agent. It is classified as N-methyl D-aspartate receptor antagonist. It acts on the brain and causes NMDA receptor antagonism. So it is used at anesthetic doses. It stimulates rather than depresses the circulatory system. That means it produces high blood pressure because of the sympathetic activity increase. So after inducing the patient based on the ketamine, propofol, or thiopentone, so we need to check whether ketamine is useful, propofol is useful, or thiopentone is useful. In a person with shock, or when the person has come for immediate surgery and the person is having very low BP because of high blood loss, so we need to give ketamine as an induction agent because it increases the blood pressure. If we prefer propofol or thiopentone in a patient with low blood pressure initially alone, so then that will be causing more detrimental hypotension that may cause cardiac arrest also. So that's why discussing in front and formulating a plan and using appropriate induction agent is very essential. So in the intraoperative management, once the person is given induction agent, pre-medication agents, analgesic agents, induction agents in the form of propofol, thiopentone, or ketamine, so then we give the muscle relaxants like bacuronium, atropinium, or panpirunium, and the person is completely paralyzed. So then if we do the intubation, we check whether the vocal cords are completely paralyzed and relaxed or not. So then after checking that the reflexes are completely absent, we intubate the patient. After maintaining the intubating, we'll inflate the endotracheal tube cuff, connecting him to the mechanical ventilator. And through that one, we provide inhalational agents like nitrous oxide and CO fluorine for maintenance purposes. In order to prolong anesthesia for the duration required, so it is usually for the duration of the surgery, a controlled mixture of oxygen, nitrous oxide, and a volatile anesthetic agent is needed for maintaining the surgical depth of anesthesia. So this is called inhalational management or inhalational maintenance of anesthesia. So other drugs like propofol and intermittent administration of fentanyl is needed, and intermittent administration of muscle relaxants is important for maintaining the patient in paralyzed state. In inhalation agents are supplemented by IV anesthetics such as opioids for maintaining balanced anesthesia, and at the end of the surgery or towards end of the surgery, volatile anesthetic agent is slowly discontinued, and the recovery of consciousness occurs when the concentration of anesthetic in the brain drops below a certain level. So this is inhalation part. So if we don't want to use any inhalational agent like sevoflurane, desflurane, or any isoflurane, so then we can proceed with using 1.5 to 2.5 milligrams per kg body weight of propofol for induction agents, followed by the propofol in a continuous dose in a very little infusion rate. So this is total intravenous anesthesia where the computer controlled syringe driver is used to infuse propofol throughout the duration of the surgery after removing the volatile anesthetic. So the advantages are like faster recovery from anesthesia, reduced incidence of postoperative nausea and vomiting, and absence of a trigger for malignant hyperthermia. Malignant hyperthermia is one of the side effects of inhalation agent like sevoflurane. So that is avoided when we are using propofol as the maintenance drug. And neuromuscular blocking agents are used for blocking the NMJ, and they are used as an adjunct to anesthesia to induce paralysis. So mechanical ventilation should be available to maintain adequate respiration, and that should be having capnography and adequate monitoring. The types of neuromuscular blockers are non-depolarizing and depolarizing. Competitive antagonists against the acetylcholine at the site of postsynaptic acetyl receptors is the basic mechanism of non-depolarizing agents. The examples include atropinium, bacuronium, procuronium, And depolarizing muscle relaxants, we have only one, that is succinylcholine hydrochloride. We call it as succinylcholine. This is the depolarizing agent. It depolarizes the plasma membrane of the skeletal muscle fiber, and it is similar to the acetylcholine. So it directly acts on the receptor and produces depolarization. So these are the two types of neuromuscular blocking agents, and depending on the type of surgery, we need to administer non-depolarizing or depolarizing agents. So the position is different. So we have the supine position, lateral position, prone, sitting, and lithotomy positions for various type of surgery. So the normal surgeries on the abdomen will be done in supine position, and the lateral surgery is for renal transplantation or the removal of kidney. In prone position, we see for the spine surgeries, and in sitting position for the posterior cranial fossa tumors in the neurosurgery. So we administer the sitting position, and for in the lithotomy position, we do surgeries like prostate and this cervical procedures on the gynecology part also. These are the various types of positions used in the operation theater. So the monitoring, basic monitoring includes electrocardiograph, ECG monitoring, pulse oximetry, that is SpO2, partial pressure of oxygen saturation, blood pressure monitoring like non-invasive blood pressure or invasive blood pressure, where beat-to-beat variability of the blood pressure is important, like in multiple comorbidity patients or more than 70 years of patients, or if the person is having a coronary artery disease, or when you are expecting major blood loss in the operation theater. When these type of indications are present, we administer intracatheter through the radial artery or femoral artery, and we provide invasive blood pressure monitoring. And there should be agent concentration measurement on the monitor for checking how much of inhalation agent is being given to the patient. And carbon dioxide measurement is very important, that is called capnography. That shows, and that indirectly measures the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the arterial blood. The end tidal carbon dioxide concentration, that means the air or the oxygen containing the gases that is released from the lungs, that is washed out back to the machine end. If that is measured, that gives us the end tidal carbon dioxide concentration that closely resembles the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the arterial blood. So that is how capnography is very important for measuring and monitoring in the operation theater. And temperature control is very important. So we don't need absolute hyperthermia or absolute hypothermia for any patient in the operation theater. We need to maintain the temperature for all the basic organ systems to be functioning normally. And the low oxygen alarm, whenever the circuit is having any low oxygen, so then we need to have this circuit disconnect alarm or the low oxygen alarms from the mechanical ventilation or the anesthesia machine part of you. So then that will be monitored also. So these are the monitoring systems we administer in the operation theater. And intraoperative management includes fluid management also. So we have crystalloids and colloids. Crystalloids are like a D5, RL, normal saline. And colloids include plasmolite or volivin, which contains plasma solutions or plasma expanders. So if you are using three points of crystalloid, that is equal to administering 1 point of colloid. So this differs in the fact that whenever a crystalloid in the form of ringer lactate or normal saline is administered intravenously, the time that remains in the intravascular space, if it is compared with the colloid or plasma expander, that time is very low. So that means if we give 1 point of colloid, that stays in intravascular space for a longer time or three times more duration when compared to crystalloids. So that's how the crystalloid or colloid is important. So when a normal person is undergoing surgery where the blood loss is not much, when the expected or suspected blood loss is not much, there we can maintain him on crystalloid for 2 hours or 3 hours duration. But when you are suspecting major blood loss, more than 1 liter, more than 2 liters like that, so we need to give colloids as well as keep blood ready for intraoperative transfusions. So in the NPO or nil per oral fluid replacement, the first 10 kgs, the volume replacement is 4 ml per kg per hour. And in the second 10 kgs, 2 ml per kg per hour or 1 ml per kg per hour thereafter. So this is like 4:2:1 ratio. If a 70 kg person comes, the first 10 kilos demands 40 ml, the second 10 kilos demands 20 ml, that means 60 plus remaining 50, 110 ml. So total 110 ml of fluid has to be given per hour for a standard 70 kilo person. So this depends on the body weight of the patient. So and this has to be supplemented and given along with any extra losses of the blood, extra losses of the secretions. When the abdominal surgery is going on, if the abdomen is open to the atmosphere, there will be radiation or evaporation of the intra-abdominal secretions also. So we need to add the replacement fluid for the deficit and maintenance purposes also. So this is how we calculate the fluid replacement for a for the duration of surgery. So intraoperative fluid replacement that includes minor, major and major abdominal procedures. This should be given at the rate of 1 to 3 ml. This is in addition to the deficit. So this depends on the number of hours of fasting. So that is given in 4:2:1 ratio, and the maintenance fluid is given with 110 ml per kg per hour for 1 hour during the surgery. And intraoperative fluid replacement for minor, major and major abdominal procedures is given like 2 ml per kg, 6 ml per kg and 8 ml per kg per hour. And during end of the surgery, towards end of the surgery, we need to bring back the patient and make the patient with all the reflex managements coming back. So when the anesthetic agents are given, all the reflexes are suppressed. So towards end of the surgery, we try to turn off the agent, inhalation agent or IV agent, which is maintaining the surgical depth of anesthesia during the surgery. We'll turn off the agents, and slowly we try to reverse the muscle actions. The return to spontaneous ventilation with adequate ventilation and oxygenation is very important. And we suction the upper airway for any residual secretions they are present. We will suck up the patient and we wait for the patient to wake up and we ask them to follow the commands. So once the first patient is completely stable, hemodynamically stable, his blood pressure is okay, heart rate is okay, saturations are maintaining, capnography or endothelial carbon dioxide is okay, temperature is hypothermic, it's not hypothermic and it is maintaining normothermia, blood loss is not more, and the urine output is maintaining. So after checking for all the parameters, that is what we call hemodynamically stable. So then we reverse the patient. So for giving the, as far as the surgery is going on, we maintain him with surgical depth of anesthesia and intermittent usage of muscle relaxants in the form of acronym or atropine. We need to reverse this with the help of neostigmine. So if we give the neostigmine, this will be neutralized. The muscle relaxants will be neutralized and the person's chances of gaining spontaneous ventilation will improve. And after checking for the adequate ventilation and oxygenation, and after the person follows the commands, we remove the endotracheal tube, which is maintaining his patent table. So how do we manage him in the post-operative period? In the post-operative period, so we check for his oxygen supplementation because there will be residual activity of the anesthetic agents on his brain, so that the person may be having respiratory depression to some extent even after the surgery is over. So for all the anesthetic agents to completely metabolize and get eliminated from the body, till that period, we need to check for his oxygen supplementation and be very careful about his respiratory depression. And obviously, throughout the procedure and after the surgery also, we need to manage his pain by giving opioids and other paracetamol containing substances. And if needed, we can put him on fentanyl and other patches also. And if the person can be managed on patient control analgesia, so that can be given. So side effects like nausea and vomiting, hypertension and hypotension, and agitation or restlessness because the person has been under the influence of anesthesia, thus that will be causing very deleterious effects on the brain. So they have to be managed by giving anti-agitation methods and maintaining his hypertension and hypotension. A chronic hypertensive person in the result of surgery and post-traumatic stress and in the surgical perioperative stress management, so the person will have hypertension. So that needs to be managed properly with adequate pain control, adequate oxygen supplementation, and we need to check for hypotension. So when the surgery had so much of blood loss in the operation theater, and even after transfusing one or two points of the blood and along with the colloids, if the patient is having a sustained hypotension for a longer time, so that person needs the help of inotropic substances and external sympathomimetic agents like adrenaline, noradrenaline, dopamine. So we need to discuss and decide which type of agents are needed for maintaining blood pressure after the surgery, and that has to be managed till his hemodynamic parameters are stabilized. So this is all done in the post anesthesia care unit, like oxygen supplementation, pain control, nausea and vomiting, hypertension, hypotension and agitation. And in the surgery intensive care unit, if the person needs extensive mechanical ventilation even after surgery. So if abdominal surgery or any neurosurgery is going on, has been done, the person cannot be extubated on the operation theater table. So he needs prolonged mechanical ventilation, that is elective mechanical ventilation. And slowly, once his blood pressure, once his intracranial pressures are maintained, and if the person needs extensive transfusions in the postoperative period, if his pH is not good, arterial blood gases are not good, they have to be managed properly. Only after checking his hemodynamic status, only after stabilizing his hemodynamic parameters and the general condition of the patient, and slowly only we can extubate the patient. So we may have to keep the patient on mechanical ventilation for an extensive period of time in the SICU with proper hemodynamic monitoring. So this includes, so our technique of general anesthesia, today's class was basically about assessing the patient in the pre-anesthesia room for his history, examination, airway examination, and other comorbid conditions, whether they are under control or not, and whether we are continuing the drugs which the patient was taking, and what type of plan and general anesthesia plan has to be formulated for providing optimum conditions of safety in the operation theater. So we discussed about the type of induction agents like propofol, ketamine, thiopentone, and muscle relaxants like vicronium, succinylcholine, which can be divided into depolarizing or non-depolarizing agents. How the patient has to be maintained on for surgical depth of anesthesia with the help of nitrous oxide, inhalational agents, or propofol alone, which is called total intravenous anesthesia. And how we are maintaining his temperature, fluid management, intraoperative muscle relaxants, and how his capnography, SpO2, blood pressure monitoring, and heart rate are monitored in the operation theater. And how towards end of the surgery, the person has to be slowly cut off from the anesthetic agents, and how the person is slowly brought back to consciousness and is allowed to breathe on his own, and how he has to follow the commands, and how after checking his airway, and how after we checking his reflex managements and all the reflexes gaining back, so then only we cut off the patient from the mechanical ventilator and make the patient breathe on his own, so that the chances of re-intubating the patient or the chances of respiratory depressions have to be avoided. So after checking extensively and confirming that the person sustains his surgery and anesthesia effect after the endotracheal tube is removed, so then only we have to take out the protocol of weaning of the patient from the mechanical ventilator. So we need to take out the endotracheal tube and make sure that the person's hemodynamic parameters are stably maintaining, and his post-operative analgesia and other complications and side effects of the anesthetic agents, as well as his surgery condition proper, is maintaining after the surgery. Okay, so this is the technique of GA, and in the next class we'll be discussing about extensive complications of general anesthesia. This is about the technique of GA, where we had our PAC, intraoperative monitoring, induction and intubation, and maintenance and emergence, and how the person is taken from the intraoperative area to the postoperative area. So now we'll check what type of complications the person can sustain because of the general anesthetic agents in our next class. Thank you. Thank you for today.